zeggen dat we ons wel in Rocha zijn de SECO-ASSIST systems. Basically what we're doing in Antwerpen, according to the SECO-ASSIST project, most of the projects that I'm involved with, that I'm postdoc in SECO-ASSIST for now. So the outline is to talk about the research and what we're doing, some basics. I don't know if you all know the basis of testing, probably do, but at least for here. So when I'm Henrique Rocha. I did my PhD at Brazil at UFMG, finished in 2016. Then I did a postdoc in France, in India, from 2017 to the end of 2018. And now I'm part of the postdoc in Antwerp to 2021 for the SECO-ASSIST project. So work mostly on testing, but I work with software engineering, bugs, testing, blockchain, mining software repositories, empirical software engineering, and a lot of other topics. So anything you can talk to me about is okay. In Antwerpen, we're part of the ANSIMO group. ANSIMO is the joint of four different labs. The lab that I work with Professor Serge is lab in re-engineering. But basically we do research on foundations, techniques, methods and tools for analysis and maintenance of software. So let's talk about the importance of testing, not only for software ecosystem, but software in general. I'm going to highlight two main reasons that we do that, usually to, well, avoid aging software maintenance and avoid software failures. But when I talk about software maintenance, the importance is well known. In 74, under the Lehman's law of software, like I said, like the software needs to be continually adapt. And that's why I think about maintenance. And in the Agile software development principles, they said like, we welcome any changes. And this is all related to maintenance. And without tests, how do you know when you break something, when you do maintenance or you change something? And this I heard last week from a conference in Faro, this is from the Faro development team. Faro is a language, but it's also an integrated development environment, has lots of APIs and ecosystems, so they're all integrated. From the main development team, they said something that's really important. They said like, if it has no test for us, it does not exist. They said that we don't care. If you don't have any tests for your thing there in our ecosystem or API, we're gonna break it. For us, it does not exist. We're gonna do the change that we're going to do, the virtual machine, the development environment. If it has no test, that's your problem. So if it has no test, for us, it does not exist. So when you talk about testing, the costs are really extraordinary. Like this really old reference in 1992 said the cost is 80% of the software's life is spent on maintenance, 80% of all resources for the software. For legacy systems, can go up to 90%. Of course, not all legacy systems. Some new, this new company, like, of course, they work more in selling stuff for maintenance, so I think they're biased towards that number, so they say 75% nowadays. I think it's a little too much. Academia usually says around 40 to 60% of the software development resources are spent on maintenance expenses. When you say that, say, all right, but how big can it be? How is that? Well, in 1980s, costs were usually like 30 billion worldwide. In the 90s, the estimated cost was 70 billion only in the United States. Now I have I'm gonna wait until later to tell a little bit estimation about how it should be now, but yeah, it's much bigger. Now I want to talk about software failures. Failures, we all know failures, but sometimes failures can have a really big impact on software itself. Not talk only about financial. Financial is the easiest way for us to quantify those types of problems, but there's other impacts. What I'd like to talk about with metal blockchain is the famous DEO attack. DEO was a contract, they raised like a lot of money. They raised, I think, more than 150 million worth of American dollars at that time. And one attacker, he found a security flaw in the contract made by the programmer. The person who programmed that contract made it flaw. It was not a flaw in the blockchain itself, it was a flaw for the person who programmed that contract. He managed to drain $50 million worth of Bitcoins in one go or two goes. So that's $50 million. And at that time, when that happens, the price of the Ethereum Bitcoins dropped to almost half of it. A lot of people lost confidence in blockchain and Ethereum technology and got out of it. So not only the financial loss was big, but also the trust that was broken between like the people who was trying to adapt to technology was also had an impact on that. Many people gave up or took a step back blockchain after that attack. So but the impacts are not only financial, but also can have trust issues or much problem in marketing. So there's much more bigger problems when you talk about that. And just so you know, at the same time, there was another contract similar to the DEO called MakerDEO, and they discovered a similar flaw in their contract, but they didn't have any problems because it was still testing. So they was testing the contract, they found the flaw, they corrected before they published their contract. So here's kind of the importance of proper testing. Another one I'd like to talk about, this one is in August 2017. This company is called Providential Financial, it's a company in the UK, and they work on loans, basically micro loans, big loans, I don't know exactly, but they work mostly on loans. And they switched their system, they switched a new system to make the appointments and to collect the loans. And here, the CEO announced it was a malfunction in the appointment app, the loans, because revenue was decreasing after they installed this new software. Before they used to collect like 90% of the debt still to collect, 90%. And here, he announced there was a problem in their software and the appointment system of the software, and that made them collect 57% instead of the usual 9% that they did. That's the day they announced. The next day, that was the biggest drop in the share price of a company. Anyone guess how much that would be in pounds? Can anyone take a guess? Because this is stock price, but the total, how much that would be? Can anyone take a guess? A number? 1.7 billion pounds. So just because of one particular software failure. Now,
but just to say,
yep.
Again, what does it mean? Does it mean that the market trades, share traders are paranoid and essentially they imitating each other's behavior? Because among a gazillion of other software failures, none has had this kind of impact.
Not that much. But the point is that a software failure can have a big impact on your because we always think of software failure, my software failure, that's not a big deal. Maybe it is. That can bankrupt a company, depending on what you're doing, what your context. And even if you don't lose money, you might lose customers, you might lose the trust of your consumers, you might lose much more than you can think about that.
But it's like a lottery in reverse.
Yes, unfortunately, yes. But I'm trying just to make a point at how big those numbers can be when you talk about failures and, yeah. But yes, it is. Of course, you never know, like if I code an app just to change some color in an iPhone, that's not a big deal if that fails or not.
But if you look at a coin, this place, and there, this problem,
or for
a
even
thing. So
this is a financial company. I'll never guess that like, an appointment app would have that much impact. Probably not even the developers themselves realize that. Say, oh, just make an appointment app. Oh, I can appoint an app. I can make this like my sleep in less than one day.
Yeah, but again, this is plain. So the reason was there. There was the whole chain of things which went wrong. Hardware management and so on. That you cannot pinpoint it to specific software like that. Yes, the words are bad.
No, but what I mean is, if you look at the trading as far as I know, or when the planes crashed, they said they were not that much problem for the stock. When they knew the problem, the stock fell. Which is what I mean, which is quite similar to this. The moment you know the problem is when the stock fails.
So it's not about presence of problem, it's about publicity. We should not be doing testing research.
It's maybe that people don't assume that systems have failures and software in particular has failures. And they happen. I don't know.
But you should be careful.
That's quite interesting to say.
Because this particular software cost $1 billion. A particular contract failure cost $50 million. Over Bitcoin. It didn't actually because they rolled back the hard fork of the blockchain just to avoid that person should the attacker should spend his funds. That was like a, again, software failures can be really costly. Even a small one, like if if my company, the app for my company crashes from time to time, that means one less cost that bought a product in my company. That's still a amount of loss. So software failures do make it losses. And when you cement our debt, all of that, for example, then you get much bigger. Like this company, they made like an estimation. Not all failures in softwares around, that's the number. That's $1.7 trillion in amount of failures. That's accounting for all people, all assets, everything that's lost due to software failures. Even the small ones, like, maybe my app crashed, I cannot buy a product in one way, so I didn't buy one particular product for 20 euros. But when you amount that for everyone, that does amount to a lot. And also the cost to try to prevent those failures or try to counteract those failures. Now this is another one that this is from only the United States, again. So they try to classify like a bad software quality practice, so like software failures, legacy problems, finding fixing bugs, technical debt. In the zone in the US, it's $2.84 trillion. But that's everything, not only failures. If you take like just the failures part, it goes like almost 1 trillion, which makes sense because the other ones worldwide, 1.7 trillion, so it kind of pairs up. So the idea of big numbers just to show that, well, this avoid failures is an important thing. Failures are a bad thing. And also maintenance, because here also get maintenance. If you look at maintenance, like finding bugs, it's going to be like almost 1 trillion in maintenance efforts as well. So we talk big numbers. And the idea of testing is just to, like I said, the main highlight is to avoid, avoid failures as much as we can, because they are costly. And also to help mitigate the cost of maintenance and help in maintenance. So just a little bit of basics of testing. Well, unit testing is the most basic stuff that we can do, and usually just try to test an individual part of the problem. Very simple. Or is it? So just as a very simple example here, let's suppose like we have a function that receives three numbers and outputs if it's each number represents a side of a triangle. So the length of a side of a triangle. If all those make the outputs just say if it's a what type of triangle is it? So it's equilateral, isosceles, or scalene. And of course, if one of the sides is invalid, it does not make a triangle. So you can say it's not a triangle if the sides are some problem. So how many unit tests do you think is necessary to foolproof this method? Can anyone take a guess? So very simple function, three inputs. So how many unit tests do I need to foolproof this method?
It depends on the branch.
But how many?
Show me this.
As you can guess, like, it's very simple. I have three inputs and one output, basically.
2 to the power of 3?
2 to the power, that would be 8.
It depends if there is interaction between the different parameters.
Yeah. A little bit. Because, for example,
you mean code or do you mean data?
Data.
All of the possible cases.
But how many are those?
Numbers are real, you know?
Yeah, but actually, if you categorize, at least 36. Like, I need one test for equilateral, because I want to test the equilateral part, because I'm okay. But for isosceles, there's three permutations, because one side is different from the other two, so that makes three permutations for isosceles, if I want to test all possibilities for isosceles. For scalene, there's 6 permutations. Different permutations for a scalene triangle. There is 3 permutations for non-triangle, where one side invalidates the triangle shape. But also I can do 7 permutations. I have 1, 2, or 3 sides length 0. That's not possible in a geometry. You cannot have a side with a 0 length. But since we talk about the function in computer science, you can have. I also have 7 permutations for negative length, also not possible in geometry, but possible in computer science. I can have 3 non-integer inputs, more or less, depending on the language. Because depending on the language, you may need to add more tests, depending on the typing system. Because I have three missing inputs, I get more or less dependent language. Some languages accept you to avoid putting some parameters and can do like some default value, but again, you should test that. And three triangles where at least one size maximum integer value. So people forget about that. Because one way for you to know if it's a valid integer, a valid triangle, is if you sum the other two sides, is not as you less than half of the other side. So if you sum like a max integer with another integer, it might blow up, might do an overflow. So 36 cases, but can be much more. But again, just this. But again, just a simple test.
Have you ever seen anybody testing this functionality with all those tests?
Well, not really.
Except for the author of the book that has...
Oh, really? I took this example from the book. Because they always say, oh, unit testing is very important, you should try to... It's simple to do it, but it is simple to cover all possibilities, not really. So of course that's why we do the best that we can and try to score as much as we can. That's why we usually use metrics for to evaluate, well, are we doing okay on testing or not? So one of the most used metrics is test coverage. So we try to say like, alright, you have state coverage, branch coverage, path coverage. So a simple program, everyone here knows what coverage is, so I can just skip it. I didn't know if it was going to be more students in the talk or not, so I tried to put more. So, again, a simple test, I have just one, and that one gives me 100% statement coverage, but Jones gives me 50% branch coverage and 12.5% of path coverage. So again, but that doesn't mean much, because even if I cover all possibilities, I may still be more problems to do with testing. So this is from a paper about a software testing survey in Canada, but it's nice because it was the field that we have. And they survey a bunch of companies, ask like, well, how do you do your testing? And most of them still do manual testing. If you look at the median, most of the companies there still do manual testing. But I think that circulates. Like I think most companies in the US and worldwide are used to do manual testing instead of automated testing. An automated test should be more easy to do it. So it's easy to do it, it's simpler. And also, I like this, like, what's the criteria for terminating the test phase? Usually most of them is like informal. Basically it's like, well, when I feel like it. But the other criteria is like, when I found a specific overage or a fixed budget. Like, the budget is over, so we stop testing. That's not really good criteria for stopping the testing phase, but that's usually what happens. So, mutation testing, who here knows what mutation testing is? Almost everyone, okay, good. But so, anyone who doesn't know, the same paper asked like for these companies, do you know, are you familiar with mutation testing? And most people, no, we're not familiar with mutation testing, so no problem. But mutation testing has some very simple slides here. You take original code, for example, Logan here, and annotate it. I change a slight thing about it. So I have different variations of the same program. That's my mutants. So then when you apply your test suite, the mutant killer. So if your test suite, if the mutated code, if the mutants pass your test suite, it survives. If it doesn't, we say it gets killed. So why do we do that? Very simple, because the idea is for to find particular scenarios where you might be, your test might be missing. So if a mutant survives, maybe your test is not testing that particular part of that mutant. So you might want to think to change or adapt your test code to that. Here's a more concrete example, a very simple one. Just have a small function here and my test. My test successfully tests this function. So it passes the test, okay? If I mutate this, so I mutate the operator here from a man to a bar. If I try to put this mutant to that test, it passes as well. So this mutant will survive. But why? Because I'm not testing two particular things here. I'm testing only if both parameters are true or false, but not if one is true and the other one is false. Had I test those, any of those, this mutant will not survive. Yeah, it would be important to test those maybe. So that's why usually this test, mutation testing is well, because it can catch those types of scenarios that you might not be thinking, or might, the program might be missing that when it was programming. And the mutation score is the measure that you use. We just take a ratio of how many Q mutants we have. So, what's the research status now that we're doing in Antwerp for mutation testing? Well, we have three, four people working mutation testing right now, and we have a specialized, I developed specialized mutation testing tools. We have one called Little Dark that's really nice for mutation testing Java. It's kind of fast for mutation testing, because mutation testing is low to mutate this source code. We also work now with equivalent mutants and mutants in the same code. So we have a lot of work there in mutation testing. And there's a big challenge for mutation testing ecosystems, especially because mutation testing is slow. So it's, if you take a big ecosystem, it's going to take days for you to generate those mutants and then to try to see what's happening. Now for test identification. This one I like a lot, it's a very new thing. So basically you have a, what's test identification? We have a suite of tests, and based on that original test that I use the C, I'll generate new tests. And those tests will be an improvement over the old ones by some metrics that they can measure. Maybe test coverage, mutation score, any metric that you want. And they're going to generate new tests based on original tests that you gave me, that but which improves some sort of metric. So the system that we have right now is based on a mutation testing. We have implemented this for the file ecosystem, for a file language. And basically, we start with the tests. Then the first step is strip the test of all the assertions. Then we get just the setup of the test, so just the what they change the object or what function they are trying to set up. Based on that, we generate new tests based on that original ones. So we try to mutate, generate some different based on what the object was doing. Different numbers, different places. We try to try out other concepts, other numbers, on different functions. We try to mutate. Then the carving is when we insert some observation points in those objects, so we can track how the objects are changing throughout the test. Then we do a symbolic execution of those test cases, so you know like what's happening to the objects. Then we reinsert some asserts on what points that we think that the objects think are changing or the functions. And then we select based on those which ones are improving the score. So it's mutation scores like those ones that are getting more mutants. If it's test coverage, it's like those that are covering more, our test coverage are bigger and better. So we select those based on the criteria that we want to improve on the test suite. We want to select those that are improving those criteria. And then we get new tests. Since it's kind of like an evolutionary approach, we repeat this again with this new test, and we keep doing this generation after generation to keep growing our test base and generate new and better and more tests, according to our criteria, of course. Now, this is very new, so we have a prototype working file, that's really good. So here's an example of the test that we have. This is a normal test, the C test that we did. We have like a banking toy example test, so it does withdraw, deposit, has a balance. So this is in Smalltalk file. This is the original test. And this is the generated test. So there's a few problems here that we're working on. So first, too many temporary variables, too many statements, too many assert statements, some strange random values like -1,000, I don't know what that random value is, but strange values. Like those parts are usually the same, they're asserting basically the same things. So they're redundant. So yeah, there's some issues. But the student still work on that. He showed me a new test now because we did like a pre-phase before generating to do a cleanup step. And to, we also look at some readability metrics and stability metrics. Should only like test that are better at readability and stability. The new tests are looking much better now. Those are the first prototypes, so we're still improving on that, still on research. So now we have working on that, a PhD student and myself. The PhD student is is also SECO-ASSIST, so we are working on this very big project. We have a prototype in Smalltalk called SmallAmp. It only works for Smalltalk. There is already a test modification tool for Java, that's why we focus on Smalltalk, because the Smalltalk has a very nice ecosystem of several ecosystems. The community is very tight together. We have some really good ties with the Smalltalk community to ask for developers for feedback, to actually find people to do qualitative analysis we want to. So we are trying to stay with. We are not married to the Smalltalk of fun, but for now it's going well for this research. And it's also trying to improve the readability, understandability, and runtime cost of this approach. Because also, since it's part of generating new tests, it's also very costly. The generation by generation, as the evolutionary analysis is also costly. Now, test exploitation is a very new thing. It's an idea that my boss search has. But it's good. I have one system, and I just transplant some tests from this system to another system that has no tests or very little tests. Of course, it's not magic, this cannot happen to every little thing, but the idea is that if two systems have very close relationship, same domain or similar features, that might be possible. For example, if I test user interface in one system, it's very close to user interface in another system. Like how you test the button, you click in the button and see if it runs something. You look if the text inside the button is the actual text that you put in there for optimization purpose. When you add an item to a list, you want to see if the item at list is added. So these are generic, I can transplant this to any system, just basically UI testing parts. So the idea is that if these features are really similar, it might be possible to transplant tests from one system to another. And of course you have a brand new system with much more tests. Yeah, we're working on that, but first we are still trying to improve the test simplification part, because we think first we need simplification, for then to try to develop transportation. There is some common ground between those two. And now for bug reports. I work bug reports a lot in my PhD, so I really like the research. So basically, a popular system has lots of bugs. Lots of bugs. I took this bug last month, the end of August in the Bugzilla for the Mozilla ecosystem, and the bug's 1.5 million, if you look, because the bug ID is a sequential number. The bug ID is more than 1.5 million. It means that they have more than 1.5 million bugs there. Of course, not all those bugs are open, but still, they got reported more than that. And when I say bug issue, test, enhancements, anything that's reported in the bug tracking system. Anything that is passive for us to study, to look at, to see what's going on. So this is one paper that I did, I think it was 2017. I was looking at the life cycle of the bugs, how they move throughout their phases. This is the regular life cycle for the Bugzilla, the official one. And this is the one used by Firefox. It's a little different from the, a lot different actually from the original one, from the one from the Bugzilla. And the percentages there are how many bugs are following their transitions. And the number is the median times in day for a bug to follow that transition. So based on that, you can see how bugs are progressing through the cycles of the bug handling phase. And I saw many papers on that, and I really interested, characterization of bugs, life cycle of bugs, there's a lot of work to be done on that. This is another one that I did, again, 2 or 3 years ago. Did a recommendation system for similar bugs. The idea is if you browse a bug, it's an old version of Bugzilla, not interface, but the principle is the same. If you browse a bug, then we have a plugin here in Bugzilla, just click and you select, look at all the open bugs, which ones are similar to the one that's being browsed by you. So you show that and you can take them or not, but the point is, and it's not anonymized by the GDPR, so I need to anonymize this. As you can see the developer's name and everything, so I should take care of that. So what we're doing in bug research right now, we have three master students working on this problem. Since they are master students, they are it's not their main master thesis, it's like internship projects or research projects, so they're more flaky. But we have one student, he just finished yesterday, he did a paper, his master ship on estimating bug resolution time, and he found some really interesting results. Interesting enough that I need to redone most of his experimental work because it's too good to be true. And other people, they're working in partnership with some company who try to map bug to defects and try to see bug localization. So very interesting topics. We have a lot of things to do in bugs and work on that. And bugs are really big things on ecosystems, so yeah, we will. So other research that I'm working on right now, so microservices, I'm working on microservices as well, so many companies, many systems that are migrating to a microservice architecture or to a service-oriented architecture. And first we did a survey, we published this last year, and it was like a survey with microservice developers. And basically you can see many of them advantages for the microservices usually depend on deployment or using the application. But the challenge, they say, most is complex transactions and testing the whole system. So testing is still a big problem for microservices, one of the main challenges when developing microservices. Of course, not unit testing. Because unit testing for microservices should be more simple. But for do an integration test, when you have different microservices performing the same thing, like a complex feature, that's much more complex to test. And many times that I talk and we talk informally to developers, they say the same thing, it's a bit more complex to do testing when you have a microservice-oriented architecture. And now I'm writing a new paper on a great literature survey. So basically, there's some students, they grab a bunch of data from blog posts, company papers, videos, but only on companies like Airbnb, Uber, Wix, Medium, Netflix, and we got a bunch of knowledge from those. And I'm going to go to the academic literature and try to contrast those, like what's the academic literature are saying about migrating from a monolithic architecture to a microservice architecture, and what are the great literature saying. So what are the companies saying, what are the academics saying, and try to compare them. Other research that I do a lot is on blockchain. And blockchain has many interesting applications because it's a new topic, there's a lot of things. So again, I'm not focused on cryptocurrencies, I'm focused on smart contracts. It's autonomous entities in the blockchain. So they function like programs, this is a smart contract. There's a big flaw in this one, actually. It's not easy to see, but there's a big flaw in that one. It's very easy to exploit. And the idea now we're working on mutation testing for smart contracts, that is like try to do more testing for blockchain. Because blockchain, if you know that, if you put a code in the blockchain, you can't change it. If you put that, it's there. The most that you can do is kill your contract and deploy a new instance of it. Then you probably lose all the data and all the clients that you had before. Unless they really know that you migrated to a new version. You can't update the version there. So you really need to be really well tested before you put something in there. Not only that, this code here for this contract seems like it's an auction contract, so an auction end product. Very simple. The logic is sound, but for the blockchain there's a big flaw in it. It can be exploited. So you really need to be very well heavily tested before you deploy something in there. Because the numbers can be big. And just to sum up, just want to talk about the importance of testing, some big numbers. I agree with Alexander, those big numbers, not every software failure has $1.5 billion loss.
So,
well, I think we'll get more money if we did that. But again, all those failures, all those problems related to lack of testing, they accumulate. It's nice for us as researchers to try to dive into that. Those big numbers are good to especially people on companies. We should do better testing. We should do better maintenance strategies. And I talk about the research, what we are doing research in Antwerp, especially for the SECO-ASSIST project. And anyone who wants to do some collaboration work or talk about it or have some nice ideas, I'm always open to talk and we can discuss and try to get some papers together. And thank you.
I probably missed something about test amplification, but how do you know that the generated assertions are actually checking for the good behavior of the program?
Not good behavior, like the
expected one.
I just did like I summarized like because the actual paper on the test amplification we published in a workshop a few weeks ago. We showed these talks what about how that's done. But basically, we reproduced the same part of the original paper that did the testification for Java. And the idea is like, when you do, let me go back to this slide, it might be easier to see the steps. Because when you do the symbolic execution here I know when the object state changes. So every time the state of an object or a function changes, there's an assertion there to verify its value.
Okay, so
how do you know this better? Here in the selection phase, because that's for all the tests, automated tests, then we look at the metric. For now, we look at mutation score, but it could be test scores. So you look at the metric that you try to amplify, that you try to increase. And you see like, all right, which of those are performing better in those in that metric? And you only select those. So those that are not passed, they are killed. So they should generate new tests for the next generation for the again. It may take some, because it's like an evolutionary approach. So each generation, you generate new tests and do it again. But they don't select the best ones. So you keep generating new tests and keep doing it.
So that yeah, I'm going to think about this.
So for this particular example, what we did is like it's mutation score. So we mutate the original code, source code, and we run the test and see which one kills more mutants. Sorry, this one, not only more mutants, but mutants that the original test case did not kill as well. So we're trying to see, amplify only those tests that are performing better than the original one.
You still need mutants and variations of the program to increase the overall robustness of the test tube.
For now. But again, the same principle could be applied, let's suppose, if you want to do test coverage. We could try to only select those tests that are increasing the coverage of your program, for example.
Is it a kind of genetic algorithm?
I thought it is, but I was talking last week with Alexander Bergel, and he told me that would be incorrect to call this a genetic algorithm per se, because not exactly, because we don't have chromosomes, we're not crossing them, and the whole test is kind of like the chromosome and also the individual. So it's kind of I think it's not correct to call this genetic algorithm. But it's close, the principle is the same. I think that's why we call genetic the approach, like, because it's not a genetic algorithm per se, but it's close.
In the case of distributed systems, in practice, I've seen something, though, which is basically one of the system in different random categories, because the product is one of the main problems. And basically, we have the system somewhere running all the time and with random failures all the time. Every time the failure race is bad, we try to analyze it and write the code with a test case for that specific failure. Do you think any of these techniques could be used to automate that kind of stuff?
Probably. But for that, I think we should implement that, like collect those type of data and see the failures. We could maybe try to make new test cases and even zonification or.
The problem is that usually those failures are very time sensitive. In the sense that you produce the failure now, but you don't know if the reason is because it is now, because it was after something or before something or whatever. So that's why usually an expert has to look at the problem, try to find the logs, and try to find out what happened, and write the test.
Very good cash, man. Me too.
Any more questions? No? So then I see what you can see what happens after the break. Thank you.